Where does man come from? Why is he here? And where are we headed? The answer to these questions can be found in the Bible. Explore the Bible and the answer to these questions with us on ION TV at 6:30 on Saturday morning.
I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me, and with the sunlight of his love bid all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within.
Hello, my name is David Baker, and I'm an evangelist. I partner with the Church of Christ that meets at 1551 East 8th Street in Mesa, Arizona. And we'd like to invite you to come to worship with us and study the Bible. Our meeting times are Sunday morning at 9:30, 10:30, Sunday evening at 6, and Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. I may be reached by telephone at 480-898-3651. My email address is sonnybaker@cox.net. Our website address is cfcmesa.com.
Sunlight, sunlight.
It's so good to be with you again on this occasion to study God's Word. I'd like to use as a text 1 Peter chapter 2 and verses 1 through 8, where Peter says, "Putting away therefore all wickedness and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings, as newborn babes long for the spiritual milk which is without guile, that ye may grow thereby unto salvation. If ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, unto whom coming a living stone, rejected indeed of men, but with God elect, precious. Ye also, as living stones, are built up a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Because it is contained in Scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. And he that believeth on him shall not be put to shame. For you therefore that believe is the preciousness. But for such as disbelieve," the King James Version says, "disobey," or disobedient, "the stone which the builders rejected, the same was made head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense. For they stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto they also were appointed." Now, Peter, throughout his career as a preacher, used Old Testament prophecy. And we see the Old Testament prophecy used very liberally in this passage as well, as he refers to the Psalms and Isaiah. In Psalm 118 and verse 22, for instance, it says, "The stone which the builders rejected is become the head of the corner," talking about the Messiah, Jesus. In Isaiah 28 and verse 16, Isaiah says, "Therefore thus saith the Lord Jehovah, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone of sure foundation. He that believeth shall not be in haste." The New Testament quotes that as "shall not be put to shame." And then Isaiah chapter 8 and verse 14, "And he shall be for a sanctuary, but for a stone of stumbling and for a rock of offense to both the house of Israel, and for a gin and for a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem." What Peter does, he takes these three prophecies and he brings them together to teach us something about Jesus and his relationship to the church. Jesus is presented to us in this passage as the cornerstone of a great building. That is the foundation of the great building, that which that building, the church, is built upon. So we want to look a little bit more closely, especially at verse 4 of our text, where once again Peter says, "Unto whom coming, a living stone, rejected indeed of men, but with God elect, precious." Now, when we look at this passage, we find, first of all, that Jesus is described as the living stone. The living stone, that is an expression that describes the strength and power of Jesus as he is the Messiah. His power is seen in the resurrection of the dead. In Ephesians chapter 1 and verses 19 and 20, the Apostle Paul writes, "And what the exceeding greatness of his power," that is God's power, "to usward who believe, according to the working of the strength of his might, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and made him to sit at his right hand in the heavenly places," that is in the spiritual realm. Jesus was raised from the dead through the power of God, and that power of God is seen in Jesus and his resurrection. Now that power is demonstrated in the authority that God gives Jesus. Once again, verse 20, he made him to sit at his right hand in the heavenly places, the last part of that verse says. Then verse 21, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion in every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things in subjection under his feet. Now when he says all things, he means all things. Everything in the cosmos, everything in this existence is under the feet and under the authority of Jesus Christ. And he gave to him to be head of all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Jesus is presently, now and forever, the head of the church until the end of time when he delivers a kingdom back to God. Jesus said as much to the disciples in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 18 when he met him in Galilee. He said, all authority hath been given unto me in heaven and on earth. If Jesus has all authority, there's no authority left for any other entity. He has it all. Everything except the Father himself is subject to the authority of Jesus and is put under his feet. Well, the power of God is seen in the works of Jesus. In John chapter 3, Nicodemus comes to Jesus by night. And he makes an observation which, had we been there, we would have made as well. John chapter 3 and verse 2, it says, the same came to him by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that thou doest except God be with him. A little bit later on, we find that Nicodemus is so impressed that he helps Joseph of Arimathea in the burial of Jesus. Apparently a disciple of Christ, a converted disciple. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 22, the apostle Peter begins the first recorded gospel sermon with these words. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God unto you by mighty works and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, even as ye yourselves know. The point that Peter is making at the beginning of the sermon is that God had manifested his power in Jesus in the miracles that he performed. And these people who crucified Jesus, they were witnesses of the things that Jesus did. They were aware of the raising of Lazarus. They were aware of the healing of the blind man. They were aware of his stilling of the sea. They were aware of his feeding 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. They knew all about those things. His power was manifested publicly and in their presence. Well, the power of God again is seen in Jesus as he is the foundation of the church. He is what the church is built on, and he's strong enough to hold it up himself. In Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18, Jesus says to Peter, and I also say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Now, when he says the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it, it's not hell as it's translated in the King James Version, but it's Hades, the place of the dead. And what Jesus is saying is that even if they put me to death, they can't stop me from my mission, my task of building the church. And so Jesus' strength against the powers of Satan are demonstrated in the building of the church. Now, the implications of that power are found in different places in the New Testament. For instance, Luke chapter 21 and verse 33, where Jesus says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words are forever. They shall last forever. You look over to John chapter 12 and verse 48, and you see the power of his word in God's scheme of things. Jesus says, there he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my sayings hath one that judgeth him. The word that I spake, the same shall judge him in the last day. The words that Jesus speaks, the teachings of Jesus, are the standard for our judgment. You look at John chapter 11 and verse 25, John chapter 11 and verse 25, and you see the implications of that power in Jesus' ability to raise from the dead. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he die, yet shall he live. He talks about the resurrection, but not just the resurrection from the dead, but from the blessedness of that resurrection for those who believe on him and obey his word. In John chapter 5, and beginning in verse 21, Jesus says, for as the Father raiseth the dead and giveth them life, even so the Son also giveth life to whom he will. For neither doth the Father judge any man, but he hath given all judgment unto the Son. Now the life that he's talking about there is not the resurrection from the dead, but it is the eternal life, the spiritual life, the justification from sins. And he goes on to say, down in verse 24, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth him that sent me hath eternal life, and cometh not into judgment, but is passed out of death into life. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour cometh and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. For as the Father hath life in himself, even so gave he the Son also to have life in himself. And he gave him authority to execute judgment, because he is the Son of Man. Now what Jesus is saying here is fantastic for those who have been following the religion that God had given through Moses. Here is one who has been given the power of eternal life or justification from sins. And people were amazed at his teaching. And so he says in verse 28, marvel not at this. Don't be surprised that I'm saying that I can forgive sins. For the hour cometh in which all that are in the tomb shall hear his voice and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of judgment. Jesus has the power to forgive sins and grant eternal life in heaven. And he will demonstrate that one day in the resurrection of all the dead from the grave. So Jesus' power, God's power, is manifest in Jesus as he serves God here doing his purpose on the earth. Now, Jesus is described in our text as not just a stone, but a living stone. Jesus is still with us. Jesus is still the foundation of the church. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15, it says, for we have not a high priest that cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but one that hath been in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. But I want you to notice, this is something that we have. This was written many years after the ascension of Jesus back to the Father. And it is said that we have this high priest. He's still our high priest. And there's no need for a substitute or a successor. In Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 25, the writer says, wherefore also he is able to save to the uttermost them that draw near unto God through him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Jesus makes intercession for them. He is still our mediator. He is still the one through whom we go to approach God. And finally, in Hebrews chapter 9, verses 27 and 28, it says, and inasmuch it is appointed unto men once to die, and after this cometh judgment, so Christ also, having been once offered to bear the sins of many, shall appear a second time apart from sin to them that wait for him unto salvation. Jesus is alive. He functions today as the head of the church and as our high priest, and he will return one day to be our judge. And if we have believed on him, our Savior, the one who delivers us from the power of Satan and from sin. Well, he is presented in our text in 1 Peter chapter 2, not only as a living stone, but as a foundation stone. In fact, the prophecies that are quoted for that purpose, to show that Jesus is the foundation stone. Again, Psalm 118 and verse 22, and the stone which the builders rejected is become the head of the corner. Well, what stone was it they rejected? They rejected Jesus. In Isaiah 28 and verse 16, therefore thus saith the Lord Jehovah, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone of sure foundation. He that believeth shall not be in haste, or shall not be put to shame. Won't be disappointed, in other words. In Matthew chapter 16 and verses 16 through 18, this is the point that Jesus is making when he has this exchange with Peter. In Matthew chapter 16 and verse 15, he asked the disciples, but who say ye that I am? Verse 16, and Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Now, when he talks about the rock, the foundation of rock is not Peter. Peter is Petros, which means a small stone. Petra is what the church is built on. It sounds a whole lot like Petros, but it's not the same word. It's a different gender, as a matter of fact. And Petra has reference to a stone that is large enough to anchor a building, to anchor a large building. The point that Jesus is making is not to compare himself or the foundation to Peter, but to show a contrast. Here is the foundation stone, and Peter is a rock in the wall built on that stone. Now, Peter uses this illustration himself in our text, but let's look at it just a little bit further. What is the stone upon which Jesus builds the church? The fact that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And the point that Jesus is making is this, that if he's not the Christ, the Son of the living God, he has no right to build the church. The church is an illegitimate institution. That's what he's talking about. I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, and therefore the church that I build is God's church. It belongs to God, and he's doing it for God. Not that Peter is his successor. Now, in order to have a successor, one has got to cease functioning. He's got to die or become incapacitated. Who would argue among those who believe that Peter is the foundation of the church or was the first foundation of the church, that Jesus was incapacitated or dead? Not me, because the passages teach that Jesus ever lives to make intercession, and one day he's going to come and get us. He doesn't need a successor because he's still functioning. And Peter is not the foundation of the church. He never was intended to be the foundation of the church. Now, you look over to 1 Peter, again, where we looked in the very beginning of the lesson, our text, 1 Peter chapter 2, and you see this illustration used by Peter to make the point. And the irony is that Jesus said these things to Peter in Matthew 16, and the Holy Spirit chose Peter to give us a better explanation in 1 Peter chapter 2. Now, 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 4 again, unto whom coming, that is the Lord, who is gracious, unto whom coming, a living stone rejected indeed of men, but with God elect, precious. Ye also as living stones are built up a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Peter is one of those living stones. He's not the foundation stone, but he's one of the living stones. He says in verse 6, because it is contained in Scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be put to shame. The one who believes on Christ, not Peter, but on Christ, is the one who's not going to be disappointed. For you, therefore, that believe is the precious. But for such as disbelieve or are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected, the same was made head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. Now, is he talking about Peter or is he talking about the Messiah? He's talking about the Messiah. And Peter makes that point rather clearly in this reading. So, Jesus is the foundation of the church. He still is the foundation of the church. He is still the head of the church, and the church moves on his impulse at his command. We are a spiritual house built up into a holy temple for the Lord, into a holy priesthood to offer sacrifices that are acceptable to him. Now, we go back to 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 4, where it says, unto whom coming, a living stone rejected indeed of men. Jesus, when he came to earth, was rejected indeed of men. In John chapter 1 and verse 11, John chapter 1 and verse 11, it says, he came into his own, and his own received him not. And you look at the earthly ministry of Jesus, and as long as Jesus was passing out goodies and performing miracles, people flocked to him. But when he started to talk about their obligations and responsibilities to God, then they began to kind of flake off. They began to leave him one at a time, or sometimes in great numbers, no longer being interested in the message. In Acts chapter 2, and verses 22 through 23, the ultimate insult is given to God and to his Son in the crucifixion of Christ, and Peter talks about it. It says, ye men of Israel, hear these words, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God unto you by mighty works and wonders and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, even as ye yourselves know, him being delivered up by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, you by the hand of lawless men did crucify and slay. You killed him. You murdered the Son of God. Now you look at verse 36. This is the conclusion of his sermon. He says, let all the house of Israel therefore know assuredly that God hath made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom ye have crucified. They received him not, and finally they put him to death. Why did they put him to death? Why did they crucify him? Why the change in their attitude toward Jesus? You'll remember in John chapter 6, he fed 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, and when they gathered up the leftovers, they had more than when they started. And so the people seeing this and seeing the great value of having Jesus as a ruler or a benefactor, it says of Jesus in verse 15, Jesus therefore perceiving that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, withdrew again into the mountain himself alone. They were about to come and make him a king. Why? Because he could feed them. Well, a little bit later in the chapter, he upbraids them because their purpose is not honest. It's not good. You look down at verse 26. It says, Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, ye seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate the loaves and were filled. Work not for the food which perisheth, but for the food which abideth unto eternal life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him the Father, even God, has sealed. And then you look over at verse 35. Again, they're still asking for food. They're wanting a potluck, and he's offering them eternal life. They want the potluck. Verse 35, Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall not hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. The purpose of Jesus was not to hand out. The purpose of Jesus was to teach about God and his purpose in us so that we might all be saved. In verse 63, it says, it is the Spirit that giveth life. The flesh profiteth nothing. So, what's the implication? I'm not going to feed you. At that point, many of the people turned on him, and they decided that he wasn't going to be the Messiah after all. They made that decision. God didn't make it. They made it. And they rejected Christ and sought his end in crucifixion. Now, when Jesus was being tried, he was accused of trying to overthrow Caesar. And in John chapter 18 and verse 36, we read this. When Pilate asked Jesus if he was a king, this is his answer. Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered unto the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. Jesus did not promise, and God never promised, a restoration of fleshly Israel on the earth, or an earthly reign of the Messiah. Never promised that. He promised a new faith, a new religion, and Pilate knew that. That's why Pilate went out and said, I find no crime in him. Pilate understood that what Jesus was doing was not trying to set up an earthly reign for 1,000 years, either then or somewhere in the future. But what Jesus was doing was establishing a religious belief. Now, Pilate was a pagan. He never did obey the gospel. He was never considered a believer, at least as far as we know in the scriptures. But I'm going to tell you that he understands a lot more about the nature of the kingdom and the rule of Jesus than some of our religious preachers today who are looking for signs in the heavens and events on the earth to indicate the coming of an earthly reign of Jesus. Jesus never promised that. His kingdom is not of this world. If it were of this world, he would have had it. He would have had his reign, because you cannot withstand the power of God. Well, Jesus is rejected a lot of times today for that very reason, because Jesus does not offer what men want. He does not offer the gratification of the flesh. And most people, that's what they want, so they reject Jesus. We're warned in Matthew chapter 7 and verses 13 and 14, enter ye in by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many are they that enter in thereby. For narrow is the gate, and straitened the way that leadeth unto life, and few are they that find it. Let's be in the few that find the way by listening to what God has to say. Well, the cornerstone was rejected indeed of men, but according to our text, it was with God elect, chosen and known before the foundation of the earth, before the creation of the heavens and the earth. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 through 20, Peter says, knowing that ye were redeemed, not with corruptible things, with silver or gold, from your vain manner of life handed down from your fathers, but with precious blood, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, even the blood of Christ. Now note verse 20, who was foreknown indeed before the foundation of the world, but was manifested at the end of the times for your sake. And the King James Version says, in these last days. He was manifested in these last days at the end of times for your sake. But he was known before the foundation of the world. God planned to save us through Christ at the beginning of time, in fact, before the beginning of time. In John chapter 17 and verses 4 and 5, we find that the preciousness of Jesus is once again highlighted when Jesus, praying to God, said, "I glorified thee on the earth, having accomplished the work which thou hast given me to do. And now, Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was." And God did that when he raised Jesus from the dead. Now, we have a duty and responsibility in the light of all this. He begins verse 4 by saying, "Unto whom coming?" We have a duty to come to Jesus. In John chapter 14 and verse 6, Jesus says there, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one cometh unto the Father but by me." So we must come to the Father through Jesus Christ. But we cannot come to God unless we have hearts that are filled with faith, unless God draws us through the teaching of the gospel. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, the apostle Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." Now, the power of God's word to save us is not that it's on onion skin and leather bound. It's not that it's in a book that we keep our birth records and our family records in. It's the message of the book. The message of the book contains information that we need to know to be saved. He says in verse 17, "For therein is revealed a righteousness of God from faith unto faith, as it is written, but the righteous shall live by faith." So we give our time to a study of the Bible, because it is in the Bible that God reveals his will through Jesus Christ, that Jesus is manifested so that we might know him and have faith in him. Well, we continue to study the Bible where I preach and where I attend worship, and we'd like to invite you to worship with us at the 8th Street Church of Christ in Mesa, Arizona. We appreciate so much your listening today, and we invite you to listen to further lessons. Thank you very much.
I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me, and with the sunlight of his love bid all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Though clouds may gather in the sky and billows round me roll, however dark the world may be, I've sunlight in my soul. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within.
My name is David Baker, and I preach for the 8th Street Church of Christ in Mesa, Arizona. I hold in my hand the Bible. It's the Word of God. In the Bible, we find the answers to the great questions of life: where we came from, where we're headed, and why we're here. We'd like to explore these questions and the answers that you find in the Bible with you at 6:30 in the morning on ION TV. Please join us, won't you?